joining me for a visual thinking warm-up. My name is Alex West, and I'm a little bit different from a lot of the speakers at the conference in that I do not have a technical background. I am not from the world of software. I actually have a degree in art history, and I spent about 10 years working in art galleries. And then for the past 7-8 years, I've been working in the film and television industry as a production designer, which is really kind of a fancy word for the person that does all of the sets and the props and basically everything that you see on screen that's not a person. It's what I do. So you all, of course, have your very famous film industry, Bollywood. I work in Atlanta, Georgia, in the United States, which is affectionately known as Yollywood. So I'm going to teach you guys a little Southern slang. If you are not familiar with it, we use the term y'all in the South to refer to a group of people. It is a contraction of you all, but you can also use it to refer to just one person if you are really Southern. So you can have a single y'all or an all y'all, which would be all y'all, big group. So now you can use that if you go to the States. So Atlanta has become a really big center for filmmaking, and so it's you've got LA, of course, and New York, and Atlanta, which we call Yollywood, in honor of you guys. You've inspired our name of our film community. So maybe we're getting close. Yeah. My hero.
It's a wizard now.
I think you're stuck here for a few more days. So this is my husband and business partner, David, who will be speaking tomorrow. We'll see what happens with his talk, since we're sharing the same new MacBook. That's going to be fun.
There's got to be an electronics store around here somewhere.
Yeah. I had to be the guinea pig. I had to go first.
Yeah, that's it.
Seems like good things are happening, though. But this, will this work with, we need this dongle. It's going to be great. So worth the wait.
Woo-hoo.
Yeah. Yay. Hi. I'm Alex. Pretty soon I'm going to have my clicker, and then we are going to go. Don't worry about that. As long as I can see the notes. I don't care about the notes.
You sure?
I need to see the notes. So close, like seconds away. All right, woo! Thank you, everybody. That was a real team effort. So today we're here to do a little visual thinking warm-up. We're going to talk about visual thinking strategies, or as it's more commonly known, VTS. So what is that? It is a research-based methodology that improves critical thinking skills through the facilitated discussion of artwork. It's been around for a long time, but it is relatively new to the software industry. It was founded in the 70s by Abigail Housen, who is a cognitive psychologist, and Philip Yenawen, who was the director of education at several museums and spent 10 years as a director of education at the Museum of Modern Art. And they originally developed this as a program for museum visitors and for school children, and it's used really extensively throughout our educational system in the US. It's really grown a lot. So its origins are in cognitive psychology and in museum pedagogy, which is how people look at art. So what kind of skills can we get from VTS? Why would you want to use this technique? First one, which is pretty obvious, is it helps with observational skills. So what we're talking about here is not just looking at things, but really seeing them, really understanding them. Speculating, turning those observations into ideas that can be shared with one another. Brainstorming, collaborating, coming together as a team and a group to develop and advance those ideas. Reasoning with evidence, being able to back up those assumptions with thought and being able to articulate the viewpoints. Cultivating a POV or a point of view, building a story, telling a story, building a narrative. And then finally, revision and elaboration, using the observations of others within your team to help refine the point of view and make it better. So it's definitely a group activity, it's a team sport. Whoop, 1 second, jumped ahead because I can't see my next slide. So I think the best way to really understand what VTS is to participate in it. So I'm gonna actually lead all of you guys through a VTS session, and then we'll come back and talk about it and talk about how you can do this in your own organizations if it's something you wanna try. So we're gonna look at three works of art together, and we're gonna talk about them with a really specific set of questions that I'm gonna ask you guys. So I'm gonna put up the first image, and let's all just take a few seconds to just quietly look at this together. Whoop, sorry, hang on, one moment. There we go. So let's just take a few seconds to look at this together. And I'm gonna come down there so I can be with you guys. All right, I'm gonna start over here. You guys, hi. So what's going on in this picture? Maybe we could turn the lights down a little bit, if that's possible. Can you guys see? Anyone? Okay. What's going on in this picture? Sorry? Okay, so he's saying that this lady's doing some cleaning. Okay, so I'm hearing setting the bed. What do you see that makes you say that? So this, we're talking about this, is looks like a sheet, and it's night. What do you see that makes you say it's night? The moon. So now we're talking about the kids, and they're up on the roof. Sorry? Oh, so what do you see that makes you say that they're wearing their night shoes or pajamas? Oh, the pants and the shirt are the same color? Okay. All right. Okay, what more can we find? The light outside the house helps to tell you that it's night. They're religious, and what do you see that makes you say that? The cross right here. Okay. What more can we find? Sorry? The kids are counting stars. Now, what do you see that makes you say that? The fact that this child's pointing to the sky. Okay, so now we're talking about whether or not they're allowed to be on the roof. And you are saying that you feel that they are allowed to be on the roof. Probably. And what do you see that makes you say that you think they're allowed to be up there? So we're saying the mother, her facial expression, the fact that she's doing chores, she doesn't seem too concerned that the kids are up on the roof. Or maybe she just doesn't know that they're on the roof. So she's not aware they're on the roof. So I heard somebody else mention that it's spring. Who was that? So what do you see that makes you say that it's spring? The daffodils. Okay, so now we're talking about what season it is. So it's spring, we see some springtime flowers. What more can we find? Sorry? It's a country style house. And what do you see that makes you say that? Because there's nothing around the house, so we're maybe in the country, and a little isolated. Okay? It's a painting. Okay, so now we're talking about the actual physical object here. What do you see that makes you say it's a painting? The border, so the frame? The proportions of the objects are not right. How so? The tree seems a little small. So the proportions are telling you more that it's a painting and not a photograph. Okay. What more can we find? Yep. Okay, so now we're talking about the children and that their body language and the fact that they're leaning the same way, they seem very relaxed, as though they were friends. Friends or family. Okay, and maybe their relaxed attitude indicates that they go up on the roof a lot. It's not their first time on the roof. They're pretty comfortable up there. Okay. They could even be twins. And what do you see that makes you say that? Same size? Similar pajamas? No? Uh-huh. So say that again. Oh, so two windows here because of you're mentioning this gap right here. Okay. And what? Right. What do you see that makes you say it's the mother? Yeah. Why are we assuming that it's the mother? It could be also be a maid doing the laundry, so it might not be the mother. Could be morning. Could be early morning. They could be lovers? Yeah? What do you see that makes you say they might be lovers instead? So maybe they're trying to hide from their parents. They're sneaking off. So now we're talking about what's inside the window. We see a little bit of a painting and a little chest of drawers. Yes. Did you have something? Yep. So it looks like we have a painting inside of a frame here. The mother's trying to make the bed. And what do you see that makes you say that? What she's shaking out here. Oh, so now we have a new interpretation. Perhaps she has just come into the room and she's lifting the bed cover to see where they are. Okay. Yes. Okay, so now we're talking about the fact that she's all alone down here working, cleaning, and maybe she needs a little help. And maybe they're escaping some work. Maybe they're hiding from the housework. Yes. The view is from another house. Now, what do you see that makes you say it's from another house? So we could be looking out another window. And is it the shape? Yeah. So we could be peering out of another house directly across into this house. The kids are pointing at the moon. Talking about the craters. No. All right, thank you guys. Let's move on. Let's look at another one. I guess I didn't really need to come up here. Six. All right, so again, let's take a few seconds to look at this together. Well, you're just jumping right in. Okay, so I heard that's a Moogle setup. Now, what do you see that makes you say that's a Moogle setup? So their attire. Okay, and what do you see that makes you say it's a John family? So I'm hearing grandfather and grandmother. And what do you see that makes you say that? Their age, their gray hair, maybe? And there's only two of them of that age, okay? So they're the elders of this scene that we've got going on here. And one of the ladies is holding a baby right here, right? Okay, so I'm hearing that maybe this is a husband and a wife, and that these are all their children. What do you see that makes you say that? Oh, there's one. Maybe four. Maybe four wives. This person has two babies, yep. And the hand holding the hand of this child. So maybe he's a helper. Maybe he's a helper for the family with the children. What more can we find? Sorry? The room in the middle looks weird. And what do you see that makes you say that? Right. So some sort of strange angles and perspective happening here. Cooking is going on up here. And what do you see that makes you say that? So just her, all of her utensils. Yep. Right here, small fireplace. Oh, so now we're coming down here to the hookah. This guy? Yeah, so this guy maybe is smoking over here. Now, what makes you say it's a very patriarchal house? Okay, so the women are all busy with the children and cooking, and the men are just sort of chilling, right? And grandmother may be asking for a chance at the hookah. Grandma. Oh, I'm hearing a different opinion over here. She's giving B told you. Guys. Yeah. Yep. So this sort of. And what do you see that makes you say he's a servant? He has no shirt. Okay. So maybe this isn't a house. Maybe this is a whole street. Okay. So maybe this isn't even one family then. Oh, yeah. So you're seeing another door over here. So, and then this open door. Okay, so I'm hearing they seem to be well-to-do, and what do you see that makes you say they seem to be well-to-do? Their clothing. Okay. Oh, so, okay, this guy you're saying may be giving some advice, and what do you see that makes you say he's giving advice? Like he's teaching? He could be describing something to him or teaching him something. Oh, lending money. Now, what do you see that makes you say lending money? Oh, so they might be conducting some sort of business transaction up here. Okay. Or a small boy getting pocket money. I know. Oh, yeah. So, okay, so let's talk about that. What's going on here? The two, so we've got cooking heat going on here as well as the cooking up in the top left. So this guy might be a doctor, and we might be seeing patients coming visit him. What do you see that makes you say that? So maybe these are medical instruments and not cooking instruments. So this woman may be making medicine. What more can we find? Oh, so okay, we've gone further. Maybe he's a doctor, maybe he's a child specialist, and maybe all these people are bringing their children to see the doctor that specializes in children, right? So all these children may be coming to see the doctor now. What more can we find? Ah, this figure. So we're talking about how still he looks and how straight, that he's not really maybe as much in motion as some of the other figures are. So we're talking about this guy right here now. Okay, so what do you see that makes you say maybe he's a dwarf? And so he's short like a child, but we're seeing a mustache. So maybe he's a dwarf. And then what do you see that makes you say he might be a painting? Just because he is so still and flat? So, 'cause he looks like he's right on the wall. Okay. So this child holding the box is maybe the box of the beetle that she has right here. And what do you see that makes you say that's a beetle box? The color. So the color is indicating the contents for you. Okay. So this figure, what is very different? His clothing is very different from the rest of the people, indicating that he might be a servant. Oh, okay, so now we're talking about the complexion, that this figure, and this one over here, that they might be different because they have a darker complexion. So this figure, and this figure. He has some shoes on. Okay, so now we're noticing that this figure with the children has shoes and everybody else looks to have their shoes off. Maybe this, he's not associated with them at all, that he's just going for a walk. He's the trade specialist. Okay. Okay. So what do you see that makes you say it's from an older era? The veranda, this, the divan. Mm-hmm. This figure? This one? So this figure may be grinding the spices, and the type of furniture and the type of dwelling might indicate that it's older. Oh, so now we're noticing that he's also bringing a pot of grain. Maybe some food for the kids here. So you think maybe three different houses. So this and then this and then this is the third. What do you see that it makes you say they might be three different houses? Because this kitchen looks different. And the doors are different. Okay. Yes. Okay. Okay, so he's saying that maybe the painter did not think of all the stories he wanted to tell ahead of time. And so what do you see that makes you say that? So So maybe artists just randomly paint whatever pops into their head. What do you see in this image that makes you say that he may not have known ahead of time everything he wanted to put in here? Okay. Okay. Right. So we... Sure. Okay. So maybe he, it's like, it's more like a song than a painting, and it just sort of flowed out of him. Okay. This one? So the proportions are not right on her. So maybe the perspective's a little odd with this figure by the pots. And then what were you saying? Oh, okay, so now we're talking about the proportions of the figures, and the shadows indicate that he may not have thought out the whole composition. It's a two-story building on the right. Yeah. That maybe he was trying to make it a 3D picture, but he didn't quite have the skills for that. Couldn't render that correctly. Okay, so that maybe this figure is entering this house and the painter wanted to represent all the activities that were happening in the house simultaneously, and they ended up laying on top of each other a little bit. Which child? This child? This is a naughty child? What do you see that makes you say this is a naughty child? The body language. And he's holding a stick, like he's about to whack somebody. Okay. So yeah, we're talking about this little guy right here, and maybe he's about to hit somebody with this stick. Sorry? Which one? Oh, this kid is saying no more kids. Too many. I don't like this competition. This is plenty. Let's be done. I want more for myself. All right. Thank you, guys. So a lot of really great observations. We're gonna go. The red color. Now tell me about the red color. Oh, all the ladies are wearing colors, right? And all of our gentlemen are in white. Except this figure. So we're back to this figure that might be a painting or a dwarf, and that he's the only male figure that's not in white, this figure. All the kids are actually boys because they're all wearing white. Now we've escalated to kidnapping. Now he's kidnapping. And what do you see that makes you say kidnapping? Okay, so maybe everybody's preoccupied with what they're doing and he's sort of sneaking off with the kids here. And this kid's maybe like, hey, don't steal my brother. Okay, so we got potential kidnapping going on over here with the potential kidnap thwarting happening right here. They've run out of money because the youngest children have no clothes. All right, I think you guys did an awesome job with that one. We're gonna move on. Go to something completely different. So let's just take a few seconds to look at this. I'm gonna get a sip of water. All right, what's going on in this picture? So it seems like a photograph rather than a painting. What do you see that makes you say that? So the figure looks more real. It's an artificial setup. And what do you see that makes you say that? It doesn't match. It's a makeshift room. What do you see that makes you say that? It doesn't look like a home. What do you see that makes you say it doesn't look like a home? The carpet is used to make it look like a room. So perhaps this is an old set or the ruins of an old theater. And what do you see that makes you say that? Okay. So there's some luxury items and the light and the carpet. But then there's a tree. And the tree can't grow on the carpet. Sorry? Okay, so now you're noticing that as we've progressed through the pictures, they've gotten more complex and more full of stuff. This one definitely has a lot of stuff. Oh, okay, so this figure is probably on a diet, I'm hearing. And what do you see that makes you say this woman is on a diet? She looks really thin. She looks very thin. She might be part of an art installation. And what do you see that makes you say that? Because it's a little bit of a surreal or an unreal environment with the tree inside this living space. She's very untidy, and she doesn't have a house. Maybe this is where she lives. Okay, so we're talking about all these books that are open and that maybe she's trying to find something. Oh, or maybe she's in love with someone and she's reading old love letters, love poems. And someone's trying to film it. What do you see that makes you say somebody's trying to film it? So she looks like she might be a model or an actress on a set. She appears to be distressed. What do you see that makes you say distressed? So her facial expression and the way that she's searching through these books looks artificial. She's reading up on witchcraft. Now, what do you see that makes you say witchcraft? Which? This one? Okay. This book. This book. No. Oh, over here. Or here. That one. Okay, so what do you see about those books makes you say, and I'm going to go point over here, that they might be related to witchcraft? And we're talking about this book, and this book. What do you see that makes you say that? The cover? So this, just the way they look. So she's having such a hard time studying that meanwhile this tree has just grown over her books because she's having such a hard time studying all of this. It could be a tree house. So we could possibly be up in the tree? No? Okay. Tree house. And there is electricity. Okay, so now we're noticing that up here in the very top, there's a lot of pages hung up. And what do you see that makes you say it might be two different photographs fused together? This one? Oh, okay. Up here. So it might be two pictures put together because we've got some landscape and then maybe she's inside and you're noticing that because the lighting looks so different because of this light, the strong light on the tree is different from this light, is different from what's going on with her. Okay, so maybe she's leading an alternate lifestyle away from the city where she's come into a cave and she's just living with nature. So everything would fit into that except for these lights and the electricity. She looks like Alice in Wonderland. What do you see that makes you say that? Everything is disorganized. She's messy a little bit. So it's a little bit disorganized. Maybe Alice in Wonderland, maybe in a cave. So because she's got all these books open, maybe she's searching for something in these books. Maybe her home was broken into and burglarized. And what do you see that makes you say that? The fact that everything's just sort of tossed about. So maybe somebody was looking for something. Or maybe she's in somebody else's house looking for something. Maybe she tore everything up. A turtle? All right, where's the turtle? Oh, and we've noticed a turtle. All right, I'm coming over. Okay, I didn't see the turtle before. Oh, this second turtle. Oh, on the carpet, here's another turtle. There's a suitcase. So what's going on with the turtles? The turtles what? So maybe the turtles are showing the passage of time. She's been there so long, the turtles, who move very slowly, have made it into her house. Or the turtles might be her pets. Okay, so now we're saying that the turtles might be symbolic of her personality, that maybe she's shy and she's going inside of her shell like a turtle, and so the artist is kind of representing that by giving us turtles in the photograph. So maybe she's trying to figure out who was here before her. Okay, what more can we find? That the tree has actually grown over on top of the carpet here. The carpet, and what do you see that makes you say the carpet is really old? Right, so the carpet had to be there a long time for the tree roots to grow over it. So the roots are not looking real, not like a real tree, they're looking like they're made of mud. And what do you see that makes you say that? Because of these folds? So it's like a prop, not a real tree, because of all the folds in it. There's a what? There's a bird's nest. All right. Oh, right here. So a little more nature happening, along with our turtles. We've also got the bird's nest here. Sorry? There's the chair in the back. Yep. So it might be a study because it has furniture, like you maybe you would read here in this chair with this lamp. So now we're back over here talking about this area. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes. Okay, so I heard she's angry, and what do you see? Hungry, and maybe trying to find a recipe. Okay, what do you see that makes you say she's hungry? Her posture, the fact that she's sort of slumped over, she looks like she's maybe tired. And there's an impatience. What do you see that makes you say impatience? Because she has multiple books open, so she's frustrated. She's not finding what she's looking for. And there's some mushrooms growing on the tree. Oh, up here?
Behind the chair.
Behind the chair. Oh, okay. So mushrooms. So maybe she's hungry because of her slumped over posture. Maybe she's looking for some recipes and she's getting annoyed because she's got a bunch of books open. And she can't find what she needs. And then we're noticing there's also some mushrooms growing over here. Okay. So now we're noticing that she likes floral, that she's got floral patterns in the wallpaper and in the carpet, and maybe she's happy. Maybe this is actually exactly what she wants. There's a natural... Oh, so maybe there was a natural disaster. Something happened into the house that drove all this in. Messed her house up. Okay. Her boyfriend became a saint? What do you see that makes you say that? Because she ended up in a cave? And she's reading about why he became a saint. So I'm hearing she looks a little depressed, like she might be listening to a breakup song. And she's tearing all her love letters. So the colors and the lighting on her and the background, just maybe a breakup, perfect breakup song. Or she could just be modeling and just trying to look relaxed. That's right. So yes, we're commenting that initially you see the really obvious things and then you start to think about what the story is. So that's a great place for us to wrap up this image. Thank you guys again for all that great input. So what just happened? What are your initial thoughts and reactions to that process? What happened? I mean, I heard we started off with the obvious stuff. What else? Anybody? You became impatient? I became impatient, or you, who became? I wasn't impatient. The more you look at it, the more you see. Right. The more you look at it, the more you try to fit it into something you would recognize. Okay? Everybody sees something different in the picture. Right? So sort of take an inventory of the physical things that are present and then make up a story that incorporates all of those objects and those people. Yes. So we started off with a really pretty simple image, and then they got more and more visually complex and denser as we progressed. We see things as we are, ourselves, so we're projecting ourselves onto them. Mm-hmm. Right. So we're all putting our own individual past thoughts on these things. Yep. Great. Right. As the time went by, people had more opinions about what was happening. Right. Exactly. So the amount of information and ideas kept increasing. Okay, so let's kind of break this down. So why does this process work? First thing, it's pretty obvious. This is accessible. This isn't an art class or an art lesson. Nobody needs a background in art to participate in this. We're just looking at pictures together. Second thing is that it encourages participation from everybody. There are no right or wrong answers in this. We're not trying to form a group consensus and all come together and agree what's happening in the picture. We're just having a conversation about it. Okay, so we're really encouraging everybody's viewpoints. It's a great tool if you have a team. Let me move on to say enhances team dynamics and collaboration. So when you read the description of this talk, you'll notice I said, you know, do strong personalities dominate your teams? This is a great tool to use because there, in every group, there's always one or two loud voices, right? And then there are a lot of people that are quiet. They're less comfortable speaking up in front of the group. They're maybe shyer. This is a really great tool to get participation from everybody. Because again, you can't say anything that's wrong because there are no wrong answers. You know, nobody knows what's supposed to be happening in any of these works of art. We're just going to talk about it together. It helps, obviously, VTS develops observational skills and reasoning. So the discussion is a discovery process. As we all talked about it together, everybody saw new things. And then we sort of developed the story, and the story kept changing and evolving as we got to hear everybody else's observations, maybe see some things that we didn't initially see ourselves. And then finally, VTS enhances complex problem solving, the active construction of meaning. So there's no learning that takes place without trying to make some meaning. So this storytelling and trying to come up with what's going on, it's built as a group conversation. And so we're creating an environment and a process for looking, thinking, reasoning, and revision. Skills that are really mission critical to anybody that's in a design or a development role. Why art? Why does VTS use art? So this is a quote from the VTS organization's homepage. Art is intentionally ambiguous, open to a variety of valid interpretations. Feelings are embedded in art along with information, triggering a full range of expression from those who look at it thoughtfully. Layers of meaning, symbols, and metaphor encourage probing and reflecting. So, first of all, art objects, they're the most complex visual things that we encounter any day. Figuring out what art tells us occupies scholars for lifetimes. The goal of VTS, similar to the goal of the popularized approach of design thinking, is to connect people with their creative side and allow them to generate their own really good solutions. We are all day long making sense of the world around us by observing it. Despite differences in background, language, age, we can all recognize what's happening in art. We all know these people, these stories, these situations. We can recognize the emotions that they're feeling. And the subject matter and the types of artwork that we can discuss are almost infinite. So this process is really adaptable to any type of groups, and you could do this forever and never repeat. Comfort with ambiguity. So again, there's no one interpretation. You know, this isn't a math problem, and at the end, you're going to find out what the answer is. We have to be comfortable with the fact that we don't know. We can all have these ideas, but in the end, we don't really know. Openness to the unfamiliar. Other than the facilitator, generally in a VTS session, everybody's going to be viewing these images together for the first time. So we're all being confronted with the unfamiliar, and we're working together to collaborate and reason and make sense of what's happening with it. So these are the kind of team-level skills that can make a difference in innovation work, whether it's a feature film like I'm working on, whether it's a web application, really applicable to a broad variety. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples of how this technique has been used outside of museums and schools where it originated. So the first one I'm going to tell you guys about is the CIA, America's infamous Central Intelligence Agency, actually has an abstract art collection. Well, why would they have that, you say? Well, during the Cold War era of the 1950s and the 1960s, the CIA ran a propaganda program where they were promoting the work of American abstract expressionist artists because they thought it was a perfect example of the great freedoms of expression citizens of the United States have. Now, as the Cold War died down, that program got put to bed, replaced by lots of other propaganda, I'm sure. But the CIA has kept that art collection. It's still there, and it's hanging on the walls of their headquarters, and it's not just there to pretty up the place. They actually bring agents down to look at this very complex imagery and sort of tease it apart and analyze it to work on their problem-solving skills. So Carolyn Reams, who is the former director of the CIA Museum, said that they'll actually have their agents come down and do a critical analysis on the paintings if they're working on a really complex problem, like an ISIL problem. And they found that it helps them be more creative in how they look at those sorts of complex situations. We don't know all the details of that because it's still considered classified, but I do have a link here to a really interesting article if you want to read a little bit more about that. Probably the most well-known use of VTS is in medical schools. And it was really pioneered by Harvard Medical School. In 2003, they launched a program called Training the Eye, and it's a preclinical course that's focused on the physical exam of patients and diagnoses. And what they were trying to do is really develop that visual literacy amongst the medical students. So the ability to reason out physiology and pathophysiology from careful and unbiased observation. So following the course, they tested the students to see what it was doing, and they found that the students that had gone through training the eye made more observations, there was more sophisticated language in them, and they were actually more accurate. So they were making better diagnoses of patients based on observation after having gone through this process of looking at and discussing artwork. There were a number of studies published about it, and it became a model program for medical schools around the world actually utilize this tool now. So, let's say you want to bring this into your own environment. I'll give you a quick overview of how you could do that. So, of course, the very first thing that you would start with is picking your images. What's important when you're looking at your images? And three is pretty common. Three that you talk about for 15 or 20 minutes each, so you keep your session at about an hour. First thing, accessibility and captivation. Are your viewers likely to recognize what they observe? We want to show things that have reasonably familiar people, places, actions, and things that are interesting. You want it to be intriguing and interesting to your audience, right? You want it to be fun for them to look at. The second would be diversity, and what we're talking about here is really just different types of images. So you notice today we looked at a photograph, we looked at a more ancient artwork, we looked at a more contemporary painting. So you're gonna have a much more lively discussion and get more out of it if you look at a variety of artworks than if you look at three black and white photographs. It's not gonna give you the same kind of outcome. Existence of a narrative. Viewers look for stories in art. This is about what's the story, what's going on. So you need to give them an image that has some kind of story in it. Because of that, realism and surrealism are probably gonna be the most successful. If you put up a still life, you know, if you're looking at a bowl of fruit, that conversation's not gonna last very long. It's gonna be pretty quick, it's a bowl of fruit. So, fourth thing, ambiguity. They need to be open to interpretation. They should contain a number of valid readings and several possible meanings. This allows for an intriguing challenge, trying to figure out what's going on, and also justifies a range of viable viewpoints, which is really the point of the process. And then finally, sequencing and themes. You all noticed what we did. We started off very simple. And then we went to the more complex image. So a plainer image, less information, less ambiguity, less symbolism, moving on to something that's very complex with a lot going on and a lot of symbolism on it. Themes, thematic groupings are just a useful organizational logic. You don't have to have a theme, it can be nice. Did anybody notice a theme today? Nobody noticed a theme today? Well, we were looking into people's homes or places, lots of windows, sort of peeking at. Again, not mandatory, but it can be nice to have some sort of organizing principle. So then, once you've got your images, you've got the questions, right? As you noticed, there are only three questions, and you ask the same three questions every time. And we'll talk about why the wording is so specific. So the first question, what's going on in this picture? Encourages storytelling, right? If you think about it and you compare it with what do you see in this picture, if I had asked you that, your most likely response would be to give me a list. I see a house, I see a tree, I see a moon. We want to be talking about the story. So hence, what's going on in this picture? Second question, what do you see that makes you say that? So this is asking your viewers to look and to gather evidence to support their opinions. It keeps everything fact-based and logical. Why do we think that's a grandmother? Why do we think it's springtime? Let's gather that evidence and talk about it. Again, you could alternate that and say, why do you say that? But that can feel a little bit confrontational, and we want to keep the conversation anchored in the image. So what do you see that makes you say that? And then finally, what more can we find? This just has the effect of making the conversation more complete. As everybody noticed, details that are not seen initially are seen the more time you spend with the painting, right? And the habit of making thorough examinations is encouraged, and it's that being thorough that makes this, you know, a serious and rigorous process. Now, I've given this talk in a couple of different countries, and I know everybody, if they take this back to their home organizations, is going to translate these questions into their own language. So the important thing is just to keep the spirit of the questions. They want to be neutral, you know, they don't want to feel aggressive or confrontational, and they want to encourage looking and storytelling. What else did I do besides the questions? Acknowledge all responses. It's very important in VTS to give participants immediate feedback. It feels supportive. It signals to the group that everybody's viewpoints are important. Pointing and be physically expressive. This was a little hard today with two sides of the room going, but you want to make sure, first of all, that we're all seeing the same thing, that we're all looking at the same thing while we're talking about it. And also, you know, as you're sort of moving your pointer or your finger around, you're encouraging people to keep looking. You know, keep looking. Keep the eye moving around the picture. Next, paraphrasing. So repeating and paraphrasing each person's response. Again, the first thing is to make sure everybody hears the comment, that we're all hearing the comments, we're all talking the same thing, having the same conversation. And then we can also use that paraphrasing opportunity to make the answer or the response a little clearer or more exact. Also, we can translate that into a shared vocabulary. You might have a design language or something else that you're trying to get your team to adopt. You can use that paraphrasing of people's observations to reinforce any sort of shared language or vocabulary you're trying to get your team to use. Remain open and accepting. The facilitator's role is to be neutral, right? You don't want to correct any answers. You don't want to add on commentary. You don't want to get super excited about something that you agree with, that you think is what's going on in the picture. You want to stay neutral. It's really about everybody's viewpoints, and everybody sees things differently. You know, some people saw a servant. Some people saw a kidnapper. Some people just saw a neighbor walking by, and that's really what we're trying to encourage. And then finally, linking the thoughts. So going back to previous comments, you know, tying things together, tying that story together from the different people in the room. Any discussion you have about artwork is going to be a lively conversation. It's that linkage and that storytelling that really makes this a catalyst for learning. You know, the diversity of insights that you get from everyone helps each of us grow beyond our tendency to see things from our single perspective. Like you said, we all bring our own context to it, but you really want to hear everybody else's context. That's going to lead to more observations. Sorry, I thought I clicked my slide. More ideas, more accuracy. And it's about debating and building on the ideas of others. We want to be able to have a civil debate to say, no, that's not what I think. I think it's this, and here's why, and back that up with evidence. So that linking and that conversation are really key. So this is kind of So I would love to hear from you guys how you might see yourselves utilizing this tool. Yes. Oh, great. Mindset behavior workshop, okay. Right. What do people really think? Not just what they say they think. Yeah. We are in the mindset, but yes, okay. Mm-hmm. 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 Wow, 200. Right. Mm-hmm. 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 Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So they're picking the images depicting the current state, where you are. Yep. Mm-hmm. Right. So learning about other people's perspectives. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I think we can all connect anger with our boss at some point. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. That's great. Mm-hmm. Okay. So where you are versus where you want to be. Yeah, that's great. Anybody else? Yes, sir. So converting ideas into a picture in order to sort of communicate that better. Metaphor. Mm-hmm. Right. Yes. Yes. Retrospectives, yes. Yes. Yeah, I've heard retrospectives before, so I think you're right on point there. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right, nobody wants to talk about failure. No. No, thank you. That's great. I'm sorry. To explore the usability of a feature. Yeah, definitely. And definitely anybody that's working in any sort of UX, I mean, observation's so critical there. You know, I think it could absolutely be very applicable. Well, I'm going to put up my slide with all of the links, and I'm also will have that on Twitter. I'll have the information on the artwork, and I'm happy to answer any questions that anybody has. You guys have been great. Yes. Sure. Absolutely. I think even if it's famous, I think it will still be effective because you're still going to hear differing viewpoints. Even if it's the Mona Lisa or something else that a lot of people have seen, I think you'd probably still be surprised at all of the different opinions that you heard and where you ended up at the end of the conversation versus where you started. Because people are really going to feed off of each other's ideas. Yes. There's a lot going on in that one. Yeah. Maybe the third one in a series and not the first one in a series. Yeah. Yeah, and you can do it with sculpture, too. It doesn't have to be paintings. You know, as long as there's a narrative, as long as there's some sort of story to suss out in there, it can be anything. Anybody else have any questions? Yeah. That's okay. I appreciate the tweeting. So it's very, very big right now in childhood education in the US. So they're finding out that it really helps students not just with their thinking skills, but also with their language skills, because they're having to put their thoughts, they're having to verbalize their words, right? And they're finding that it's really good with students that speak a foreign language and are coming over and trying to learn English. So again, it's great for diverse groups. Any group where you're really trying to bring people together and get that input from everyone. Because I think, you know, everybody spends a lot of time building diverse teams, but if you're not getting contributions from everyone on the team because they don't feel comfortable speaking up, you don't really have a diverse team, because you're really just hearing from the one or two really loud people, right? So creating an environment where people feel comfortable sharing their ideas will overflow into other areas. So really anything that's team-based, I think it can work. And it's, you know, it's slowly sort of trickling into these other industries out of the educational system. I mean, I really think you could do it however, whatever made sense for you. Weeklies would be great, but monthly would be great too. But you're going to get more benefit. One time, you're probably not going to get a ton out. It's a fun exercise. You know, it's a fun way to break up an afternoon. But I think, you know, once a month, I would say, would probably be a minimum. Yeah. Or at least, yeah, once to really get something out of it. Otherwise, you could still do it, but you might not really see the results from it. Yeah, yeah. Right. Right. Well, and you could, I mean, you could do it remotely. You could share images remotely. Sure. Be a little, I mean, I think, yeah. If you just did a shared presentation, because I think you just would still want to be able to move the cursor around, right, to do that tracking of where, what you were talking about. But it could really help with diverse teams. Again, because you want all those different viewpoints, right? That's the idea. Yeah. Well, thanks, you guys. You were awesome. I really appreciate everybody's participation. You are a super lively group. Thank you so much. And if you think questions later, please feel free to tweet me, email me. You can find me.